We've already covered, you know, Signal, WhatsApp, Facebook private messages, these kind of things. Peer-to-peer, sort of two-person communication, which hopefully is end-to-end. And it means that no one can get in on that conversation, impersonate us, read any messages, put in any messages themselves, even the server, right? And this is a really good thing. This doesn't work as well in group messages, right? And maybe people don't actually notice. Last time we talked about end-to-end encryption in apps like Signal, WhatsApp, Facebook Messenger. Now, WhatsApp and Signal implement this by default. Facebook Messenger has a private conversations thing you can enable, and you definitely should enable. So, you know, don't use a default because they'll be reading your messages. But these things kind of start to break down when we're looking at groups, right? What's true in terms of sort of cryptographic security, what's true between you and me is not the same when we bring Steve in, and that's for a lot of reasons. So let's imagine that we've got three people in a conversation, right? Or maybe just a couple of people. So I'm here, this is Mike, right? And so we're actually using not Alice and Bob this time.
They'll be glad of having a bit of a break.
I know, right? I mean, I thought about using it just to keep the trend going, but let's not. So this is Sean, this is Steve over here. Normally, when we're talking about, you know, one of these applications, I will have some kind of shared key with you, and we've got this double ratchet going on where we're sending messages back and forth, keys are being updated. So I will have a kind of encrypted communication channel with you. Now, of course, this is going through a server, but I'm not drawing the server in this image. There's a few interesting properties that this particular conversation has. The first is obviously it's secret, right? This is encryption. Also, it has something called perfect forward secrecy, which means that if someone cracks one of our keys, they can't use that to go back and crack all the other messages previously to this, because the keys are constantly updating and you can't go backwards. It also has this kind of self-healing or post-compromise security, which means that if you, let's say someone cracks one of my keys, if they sort of look away even for a second, we can have some more communication and that problem goes away. Essentially, to continually eavesdrop on our conversation, not only do you have to break one of our keys, but you also have to see every single message from then on. If you miss one, you're out. So the question, I guess, is if we wanted to implement group conversations, which is where I'm sending messages to both you and Steve at the same time, can we still do these things? And the answer is a little bit, but not totally. So let's imagine now we've got a three-way conversation. Now, remember, I have already got channels, but I've been perhaps talking to you beforehand, right? And you and Steve have been talking as well separately, right? If it's the case that you're introduced to a group where you haven't been talking to them, you will form a two-way conversation with that person immediately, right? As a sort of prerequisite, right? It's the way it's normally done. Well, I suppose the sort of naive way of doing this would just be, but whenever I want to send a message to the group, I send a message to both of you using our pairwise channels, right? And then we have the benefits of the security of each of these channels. I send that same message once encrypted using our key pairs, and once encrypted using mine and Steve's key pairs. And then it's kind of up to you and Steve to make sure these messages are in sync. And if you then send a message, you're gonna send it this way. This is how iMessage works, right? This is not stupid, right? The benefit you get is that each of the messages has the guaranteed security that we had with this sort of pairwise messaging. Self-healing, perfect forward secrecy, this kind of stuff. The problem is, the more people you add to this group, so maybe you're a member of some kind of school thing, 50 people in the group, you're sending 50 messages, right? And if you're not sending a text message, maybe you're sending a video, suddenly the bandwidth becomes actually a bit of a problem. This may not be an issue depending on the application, right? But WhatsApp, Signal and co have decided this is a bit of a problem, right? And this is not how they're gonna do it. The next thing we could do is we could say, well, why can't we use the same kind of protocol to establish keys to get a kind of group key? So you and me and Steve all team up, we do our Diffie-Hellman in some way, and that gets us one shared group key that we can then use, right? So then I encrypt a message to you both with the one group key. Now, of course, in practice, I would just send the one message to the server and it would spread out. So this would be called server-side fan-out. So single message from me to the server knows it has to go to the group and it sends it out. Now, there are ways to turn Diffie-Hellman into a kind of three or four or n-way Diffie-Hellman. They're usually using trees where kind of two of us will do an exchange and then someone will do an exchange with that and so on, all the way up to the top where that's everyone's key. The problem is that this takes time. It involves all the parties. And so implementing this in a way where Steve doesn't have to be online at the same time as me and at the same time as you, That's a problem, and that's another of the things that we get from our pairwise messaging, right? This asynchronicity. The other problem is that how often do we do this, right? If I create a group key with you and Steve, and we chat for 2 years using that same key, maybe someone broke it 1 month in and has been reading all our messages for nearly 2 years. Huge problem, right? So there's no self-healing, really, unless we recompute these keys regularly. So how does it actually work, right? And it's kind of a compromise. What we do is we use our pairwise channels to establish a key, and then we use group keys. Kind of the big problem with this group key idea is that the Diffie-Hellman key exchange is complex, and if people haven't even got their phone switched on, that's a huge problem. One of the nice things would be if you and me could add Steve to a group when his phone's turned off, and then a month later he remembers, turns his phone on and gets all the previous messages, that would be really good. The way we do this is something called sender keys. So I'm gonna write sender keys here. Each person, a bit like our sending and receiving chains in a normal protocol, each person comes up with a sending key, right? This is iterated every message, right? So we have this perfect forward secrecy. So how do I give this to you? Well, I use the two-way communication we already have. So I have a sender key for me, you have a sender key for Sean. This is not gonna work.
It's gonna go wrong, isn't it?
I've not thought this through. And this is a sender key for Steve. I mean, this is a shambles. And now there's only one letter. Okay, all right. It's me. So at the very beginning, we say, well, we've established a group. Right? I send you a message that says, this is my sender key for this group. I send Steve a message that says, this is my sender key for this group. You all do the same. It's a few initial messages, but it doesn't have to happen online. Right? I can send a message and Steve can pick it up later.
So that might sit on the server waiting for him?
Yeah, might sit on the server, just like a normal WhatsApp message. The server can't read it because it's protected using our end-to-end encryption. Right? From then on, whenever I send a message, I send it encrypted using my sender key, and then I ratchet my sender key one tick.
If you are sending to someone you perhaps haven't had that before, someone said, hey, add this person to the group because they've just joined the school or something in your previous season, then presumably that then starts to use the stubs that we had in the previous thing, weren't the stubs?
No, so what will happen, yes, you mean the pre-keys? Yeah, so what will happen is, let's imagine that we add a fourth person to the group, Dave. Dave use WhatsApp?
He does now.
So Dave turns up. I've never spoken to Dave before on a mobile phone, right? So I will then perform a quick triple Diffie-Hellman handshake with Dave using the standard pairwise protocol we have. And then I'll use that to distribute my sender key for this group. Right? Now, the good thing is everyone can do this asynchronously. There's an initial burst of messages that you have to send, which kind of increases linearly within the amount of people you have. 20 people means 20 sender keys I have to send out, but the server will handle most of that workload for me. Everyone will know what key I'm going to be using because they just keep their receiving chains in sync with my sending chain. The disadvantage, and this is the key problem with group messaging like this, is that we've lost our self-healing property because these sender keys don't change. They just ratchet along. We can't go back and find out a previous one, but if anyone gets my key, they can then intercept any message I ever send into this group, and they can impersonate me by encrypting a message with that same key, right? And there's no way of detecting this. Right? Now, no one mentions this in group conversation, but this is true of most group protocols, right, at the moment. It's not an absolute disaster because, you know, breaking these keys is not easy. Right. But essentially, if we have a pairwise conversation and we invite Steve, what we've done is we've decreased the security on our communication without realising it.
We've gone from a double ratchet to a single ratchet, is that right?
Pretty much, yeah. Right. So we've lost our Diffie-Hellman over the top that keeps things sort of self-healing, right? This post-compromised security. There are papers out there now that have solutions to this that maybe will be implemented. They'll obviously have to be verified that they work. And stuff. People will eventually solve this problem, but at the moment it is not solved. Right? There's another problem. Who's in this conversation? Right? And do we trust everyone in this conversation? Remember that we looked at our safety numbers. Right? This was essentially your identity combined with my identity in a sort of hash form that shows, and if we both have the same, we know we're the only two in this conversation.
As an aside for people who are interested, I've gone through two different phones since then, and so therefore you've no idea who I am.
Yeah, we haven't verified our public numbers since you changed your phone. I'm kind of taking it on trust, and I'm a bit skeptical.
We'll have to do it again today.
Yeah, we'll do it again. So this is all very nice for two-person conversation, but for a multiple-person conversation, there isn't really a mechanism for doing this, right? You could kind of go and verify all of your individual safety numbers with each pair, right? That would help. It's a lot of work, especially if someone you don't know gets added to the group. Maybe you're not in contact with that person sort of physically. This is another drawback, right? And actually, there was an essay produced by someone from GCHQ recently that suggested that quite a nice way for the government to get access to some of these conversations for sort of crime purposes would be just to be added as a silent party to this conversation, right? Maybe the app could just, whenever you create a group of three people, it's actually a group of four people where one of them is the government. I'll leave it to the comments to decide what they think of this.
Now I've got the token, so I can load a value in, add the value from my register into it, and store it back and hand the token. And now I've got the token again, I can load something into my register, add something onto it, throw it back, and pass the token on. And I've got it, so I can load the value in, add the value from my register, store it back.